Suppose that a firm produces tractors, snow blowers, and other lawn and garden equipment. Traditionally, they've distributed and sold those tractors, snow blowers, and other pieces of equipment through big box stores such as Home Depot and Lowe's. Now, management is pondering a shift in strategy. They've decided that they'd like to open their own chain of retail stores where they will exclusively sell their own products, their own brand of equipment, and no other brands. Management articulates the rationale for this strategic shift. They tell investors that they will improve the profitability of their business because they will capture the profit margin currently being generated by these outside retailers such as Lowe's and Home Depot. In other words, Lowe's and Home Depot mark up the product that they purchase from this manufacturer, and they then capture that markup when they make a sale. The company's arguing, why give that markup to Lowe's and Home Depot? We'll take it for ourselves by directly retailing our own products in our own chain of stores. Is this sound logic? I'm going to argue that no, it is not at all sound strategic logic. We are going to capture the margin or the markup. What does that mean? Well, if we were to supply something in-house, in other words, if we were to make our own components instead of buying them from an outside party, the argument is we won't have to pay the profit margin that the supplier of that component is generating. If, such as this firm, which is selling snowblowers and the like, we retail it ourselves, the argument is we capture the profit margin that the retailer is generating when they make a sale. Why is this argument about capturing the margin a fallacy? Well, think about retailing for a moment. This company is going to go out there and distribute and sell their own products in their own stores. Will they capture the profit margin? Well, yes, they will. But what will it take to capture that profit margin currently being generated by Lowe's and Home Depot? You have to invest in a lot of assets. There's no free lunch. You have to go out and build stores or lease them. You have to hire staff. You have to put fixtures in those stores. You have to train your staff and your salespeople and compensate them, create incentives for them to sell your products. Train them in how to do so. That means it's costly to go out and try to build that chain of stores and execute that strategy. There's no free lunch. You can't just capture the margin without having to spend a lot of money to do so. And the question is, are you spending it appropriately? The real issue then is, who will conduct that retailing activity in the most efficient way possible? Who will generate the best return for investors by building out and operating retail stores? And the question then becomes not, are you capturing the margin, but can you retail your products as effectively as outsiders can do so? Who's going to do it and generate a better return on assets for investors? And so you should only move to forward or backward integrate if it makes economic sense. You shouldn't do it simply because you're going to capture that markup or margin. Vertical integration, that's the strategy we're talking about in this lecture. And there are two forms of vertical integration. Let's suppose we're a manufacturer of personal computers. We assemble personal computers, a firm like Dell, Hewlett-Packard, or the like. Backward integration means that the manufacturer builds its own components, its own hard drives, it designs and builds its own operating system, or perhaps its own microprocessors. Forward integration means it's choosing to distribute its own products through perhaps its own retail store network, like Apple does when it owns and operates its own retail stores in malls throughout the country. What are some examples of vertical integration? For forward integration, an obvious example is Apple and its store network. But we have other companies that have embarked on forward integration strategies as well. Ducati, the Italian motorcycle company, owns a chain of stores that market its products. Disney stores. In many malls around the country and around the world, we see Disney operating its own retail stores, selling exclusively Disney products. To go outside of the consumer products business, we might look at a firm like Fresenius. Fresenius is a company that makes dialysis equipment, headquartered in Germany. In many countries, especially in the United States, they've chosen to forward integrate. They also operate dialysis clinics, where patients come in for treatment. They're using the dialysis equipment made by Fresenius, but then you also have Fresenius medical staff performing the treatment on patients in these clinics, a strategy of forward integration. What about backward integration? Do we have some examples of that? When Apple conducts the work to build, design, and sell its own operating system, that's backward integration. Many of its competitors, such as Dell and Hewlett-Packard, do not make their own operating system. They're not backward integrated. They're buying an operating system from an outside party, namely Microsoft. We also see that Weyerhaeuser is backward integrated. They sell paper products, cardboard, and other things, but they own their own forests. They cut the timber and then manufacture the products. So they're backward integrated. They're going back toward the earth, and they're owning the whole process from raw materials through finished paper products. These are examples of backward integration. So let's dig deep on a story of vertical integration and see whether it makes economic sense. And here I want to look at the saga of Disney stores. An interesting one because it's a strategy where vertical integration may have made sense at one time and then perhaps became more questionable as a strategy as time evolved. As different players emerged in the toy retailing business, as new pressures emerged competitively that Disney had to face as it operated these stores and malls around the country. So when did Disney launch this forward integration strategy? It happened early in the tenure of Michael Eisner as CEO. During the 1980s, Disney launched retail stores. And initially, they prospered. And so Disney opened more stores, and they grew the business, and they achieved great financial success. Around the beginning of the 21st century, though, the chain began to embark on some difficult changes. It was struggling. Financial performance had lagged, and the company didn't know how to turn the business around. Finally, they chose to strike a deal with Children's Place, another retailer known for being able to retail children's apparel quite successfully in its own chain of stores. Under this agreement, Children's Place would take over the operation of Disney stores in malls around the world. Now, this didn't mean they would rebrand the stores. The stores would continue to operate under the Disney brand, but Children's Place would bring its retailing expertise, its knowledge, its talent to these stores to try to improve their profitability. It didn't work. After several years, Children's Place chose to terminate the agreement with Disney. It chose to turn the stores back over to the Walt Disney Corporation. Now Disney faced an important choice. What do we do? Do we take back control and start to operate and manage these stores for ourselves? Or do we shut down the stores? Do we admit that perhaps this strategy, which was once a prosperous one, no longer makes sense given a new competitive environment? After all, people are now buying their toys on the web. More and more, we're buying toys from Walmart, from Toys R Us, and Target, not from independent toy stores in 2014. Times have changed from the 1980s when Eisner began this forward integration strategy. Disney talked it over and decided to keep the stores. They put Jim Fielding in charge of the stores, and he began a strategy of redesigning the Disney stores. The goal was to make them more of an experience. What was going on there? Well, interestingly, at the time, Steve Jobs was on the board of directors of Disney. Having sold Pixar to Disney, he took a seat on the board, and he became a prominent shareholder of the Disney Corporation. And they consulted with Jobs. After all, he had forward integrated and opened Apple stores, and that had been very successful. Jobs' argument was you should only forward integrate if you're creating an experience in the stores that helps you raise willingness to pay, where you are truly enhancing the competitive advantage of this unit, creating something where people are willing to pay more for the product because you're retailing it yourself than if they were to buy the products at Walmart or Target. And are you selling enough unique products that aren't sold on the web or at Walmart, Target, and Toys R Us that draws people in as they see this exclusive offering in your own stores? So Disney began to redesign. And they put a lot into it. In Manhattan, they shut down the store and actually moved to a new location with a more experiential design. They wanted to move more toward the kind of retailing experience that we see at a store like American Girl, where girls, young girls, go in to buy dolls. But not only do they buy a doll, they can take their old dolls to the hospital to get them fixed if they're broken. They can go to the cafe and have lunch with their doll. They can get the doll's hair done at the salon. In other words, American Girl made something that was deeply experiential, something that you couldn't outsource to a Walmart or a Target, something you could only do in a store that exclusively sold your own products. Of course, this was expensive. You don't do this with little money. You've got to put a lot of money in. And the question is, can you generate enough new revenue to justify that? There's an important point here, right? If you're going to operate your own stores, you've got to do something different that truly enables you to retail your product in a way that others could not do it for you. After all, Walmart and Target are much more efficient, much more effective. They have a lot more expertise in how to run a retail store. And they, therefore, have lower costs than you. The only reason, therefore, Disney should own its own stores is if it can raise willingness to pay for the products in the stores and for other Disney products that are sold in different places within the Disney portfolio. Note the difference between Disney and Apple. The Apple stores are clearly experiential. After all, you go there, you receive training, counseling, questions, you go to the Genius Bar. There are things that happen in the store that aren't going to happen at a Best Buy. And so therefore, you are adding value by owning your own store network. It's a little less clear if Disney has that same kind of value add by operating its own retail stores. So you see the conundrum Disney faces. Create more of an experience. But if it's too much of an experience, if you can easily meet the characters such as Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck at the stores, then why go to the park? If you have too little of an experience, then why not go to Target, buy the products less expensively? This is a real conundrum. You need the experience to give a reason, a rationale for why you should operate your own stores, but you don't want it to be too experiential because you don't want to cannibalize your efforts to drive revenue at the parks and in other locations. One happy medium that some companies have chosen in terms of vertical integration is operating flagship stores. Think American Girl or M&M World, right? You can buy M&Ms in Manhattan at a store where they only sell the M&M family of products. Or you can buy American Girl toys at American Girl stores. But is there one of these stores in every mall in the country? There's not. They operate flagship stores. Just a few of these stores in certain locations, they draw people in, their destinations. They help build the brand and raise willingness to pay for the products, but they're not trying to exclusively retail products only in their own stores, and they're not trying to operate one in every mall in the country. So what then is the overall rationale for vertical integration, now that we've looked at the story of a few companies trying this strategy? Well, first and foremost, you may do it because you have this holdup problem. You know, the oil refinery and the pipeline. Why might they come together and vertically integrate? Because each is so dependent on the other that they can't come to a contractual agreement and hold to that agreement in an effective manner. Each is worried about opportunistic behavior on the part of the other party. You may do it because there's some synergy between businesses at different points in the supply chain, economies of scale or scope, perhaps. You may vertically integrate. Perhaps you might backward integrate, for example, if you want to secure access to a crucial input. Perhaps this component or raw material is scarce. You're worried about having enough of it to be able to produce enough of your finished product to meet customer demand. So you're going to backward integrate to make sure you've got access to key raw materials or key inputs. You may even do it to foreclose access on the part of your competitors, to stop them from having easy access to a scarce input. You also may backward or forward integrate to offset the bargaining power of suppliers or buyers. What do I mean by that? Suppose you have some powerful suppliers who have negotiating leverage over you. Maybe you backward integrate so that you have a little more power at the bargaining table. You maybe know more about the cost structure of suppliers and what it takes to produce that good. And you have an alternative. You can get the product from your own factory and not have to rely on the outside party, and that gives you leverage at the negotiating table. Similarly, you can do the same thing with offsetting the bargaining power of buyers. If you're worried about the fact that Walmart is such a tough negotiator at the table when you're looking to sell goods to them as a retailer, perhaps you want to retail the good yourself in certain stores, find a way around Walmart so you're not as dependent on them. Certainly, you may do it to elevate barriers to entry. The more vertically integrated you are, the more expensive it is for an entrepreneur to come in and replicate that strategy. It's expensive for you, but it also raises the barriers for new players to come in. You may do it to enhance your ability to differentiate your product in the product markets. Can you raise willingness to pay through the kind of experience you create in your own distribution channel, something Apple has tried to do and Ducati has as well. And finally, are you acquiring important information that you otherwise could not acquire? Now, what do I mean by that? Well, if you leave retailing to outside parties, that means they're the ones touching your customer every day and talking to them. But maybe you want to be the one talking to your customer every day because there's crucial data, information you could collect through that interaction. And therefore, you want to be forward integrated because you want to be closer to that customer. Well, that all sounds wonderful. There must be some risk or cost to vertical integration. There sure is. There's a real downside here we have to consider, and it starts with dulled incentives. Think about being backward integrated. If I'm not backward integrated, if I simply buy my components from outside parties, they, the independent entrepreneurs running those component manufacturing businesses, they have every incentive to work hard. They're playing with their own money, and they want to generate a good return. If, on the other hand, I have my own factory, and I have a factory manager making a salary, they don't have the same incentive to really go after this business because they know that basically the product they make has an automatic customer in the downstream manufacturing operation within the same corporation. So that's an issue. There's also the issue of conflict of interest that emerges. So you now have forward integrated, but now you're competing with your own customers. Apple is competing with Best Buy, yet Best Buy is a crucial Apple customer. And sometimes that creates conflicts of interest, and that can be difficult. Vertical integration also means it reduces your flexibility to change partners. If I'm outsourcing and I don't like what a component manufacturer is doing, I can switch. I can go find someone who's doing it better or someone who's got the next great technology. But if I'm doing it myself, it's harder to exit that business and to change technology, to change processes, to do it differently. There's also higher fixed costs in the business if you vertically integrate. And that can be difficult when times are tough. During a recession, if you've got high fixed costs and business starts to sag, can you cover those fixed costs? It's also harder to get out of the business. The exit barriers rise significantly. And there are internal conflicts that emerge as you try to get your different parts of the company to work together. One has to sell its parts effectively to a downstream business, and you have to use some artificial price to negotiate that internal sale for purposes of being able to record and track performance of each unit. And battles can emerge as people try to understand, well, what price should we use? What transfer price should we use to move a product from component manufacturing to final assembly? And lastly, there are costs associated with managing very different businesses. There are really different managerial requirements to running a retail chain versus a manufacturing operation. Can the same executive team oversee such different businesses? Now, one strategy that some have chosen as an alternative to full vertical integration is what we call tapered or partial integration. This is where you use some outside retailers as well as your own stores. You use outside suppliers as well as your own factories. You use a blend. Now, what are the benefits there? Well, you might expose your in-house units to outside competition. And that might be a way to make sure everyone has the incentive to maximize performance. It gives you more flexibility, and it allows you to learn quickly because you can transfer knowledge from outside parties to internal units and vice versa by having a bit of both in the same firm. You can embark on strategic outsourcing, choosing carefully about where you might do so. And you may have deep relationships in many cases, not just a transaction. So you have a long-term partner as opposed to full vertical integration. The Japanese automakers really did this effectively in the 80s as they grew their business, and in contrast to General Motors. General Motors was highly vertically integrated, while the Japanese used long-term relationships and long-term partnerships to work with suppliers who were outside parties. But it wasn't just a handoff, dumping product over the wall from one factory to the other. It was an intense relationship where employees were in each other's factories working hard to coordinate their activity, much like they would be if they were employees of the same corporation. But in fact, they weren't. They were separate entities, but they were partnered closely to achieve optimal performance. And that kind of long-term relationship can be an alternative to full vertical integration. What have we witnessed in recent years about vertical integration, particularly in developed nations in many industries, such as computers and automobiles, we've seen a dramatic decline in vertical integration. Well, why might that be? Well, let's go back to transaction cost theory, the theories produced by Coase and Williamson that we've talked about in prior lectures. The transaction costs associated with using the market have gone down dramatically. In other words, I can outsource much more easily today than I could 30 years ago. The web and easier travel and communication around the world has enabled me to partner with people in very different parts of the globe and to work with those who are much more efficient at doing something that I could be myself. That was much more difficult to do in the 1950s and 60s, and so vertical integration may have made more sense for a firm such as Ford or General Motors. But today, we don't have to do that necessarily, as the transaction costs of working with outside parties have fallen considerably. So let's take a look at an example of a highly successful vertically integrated strategy, one that's really counterintuitive, that has cut against the grain of what many in their own industry have been doing over the recent years. And that would be a Spanish retailer named Zara. Zara has been wildly successful in recent years while pursuing an interesting vertical integration strategy, in contrast to many of their rivals. Zara produces a significant portion of their own clothes in their own factories in North Africa and in Western Europe, near their own home base in Spain. Why is that unique? Well, many of their competitors, such as H&M and The Gap, these apparel retailers don't produce any of their own products. They are purely marketing and retail machines. They outsource all manufacturing to low-cost players in Asia or Latin America. Now, Zara has been very successful, and they've outperformed the average firm in the apparel industry. How have they done it, and why has vertical integration helped them when, as we've said, many companies have moved away from vertical integration in recent years? Well, they pursue something called a fast fashion strategy. They're not looking to be the company coming out with the bleeding edge fashions before anyone else. They're looking to the great luxury apparel companies who are premiering new fashions on runways in Milan and Paris. And then what they're doing is pursuing a fast follower strategy. They want to move quickly, nimbly, and flexibly to be able to see what's hot out there and bring it to market, and to do so at a price point that's much lower than what luxury apparel houses like Gucci might do. How have they done that? Well, they produce their products in small batches, and they change their product mix very quickly and constantly. They're not producing huge batches of the same goods and putting them in all their stores for lengthy periods of time. If you go today, you'll see different clothes than you saw a month ago. And you may not see hot clothes that did very well stay in the stores for very long. Now, they don't produce all their clothes in-house. Interestingly, they've used a tapered integration or partial integration strategy. They've outsourced some and kept others in-house. What have they done? Well, those fashions, those fast fashions that they want to be able to change very quickly, they do those in their own factories. The basics, T-shirts, for example, things that don't change much year to year, they outsource those to low-cost manufacturers in Asia, capitalizing on the economies of scale and the efficiencies that those manufacturers have. So what are the benefits of this vertical integration strategy at Zara? Well, they don't end up with a ton of excess inventory if they make a wrong bet on a particular fashion. In other words, they're making fast, small bets. What's the result of that strategy? Being able to work very closely with their own factories, many of them in close proximity to their corporate headquarters in Spain. They're able to quickly change their product mix. They're not making a giant bet on a new fashion. They don't have to sign a contract with someone in Asia with long lead times, and they don't have to commit to buying thousands and thousands of the same piece of new fashionable clothing. As a result, by working with small, fast bets, they have far fewer markdowns. And when they mark down a product, it tends to be by a much smaller percentage on average than their rivals. They're not dumping excess inventory with sales all the time. Now that's pretty incredible. To be able to reduce markdowns is a huge boost to profitability in the retail business. Of course, there is a disadvantage to this vertical integration strategy. Their labor costs are much higher than their rivals. Producing goods in Western Europe and in North Africa Well, that is much more expensive than doing so in Asia. But how do they make up for that? By being flexible. Being able to produce in small batches very quickly means fewer markdowns, means having to dump excess inventory much less frequently. The fewer markdowns and the smaller markdowns mean that they totally offset the labor cost disadvantage that they have and actually have better operating margins than their average retail rival. Well, if this is such a great strategy, why aren't other apparel retailers following it? It's fundamentally risky. You have to be bold to be different, and you have to take some risk. Zara's been willing to do it. Most in their industry have not been willing to do it. What are the risks? There are a tremendous fixed costs associated with backward integration at Zara. You have to build these factories, and that's expensive. And those costs are fixed. If you don't utilize the full capacity of those factories, then you've got a real cost problem. There are also tremendous exit barriers. What happens if things don't work out at a particular factory? Can you shut it down? Well, if you're operating in Western Europe, given the law and given the political context, it's very difficult to downsize or shut one of those factories. You cannot get out easily. You're tied down, and that's a risk. You also have to be able to fund these capital investments, and that means having to take out more debt, perhaps, which Zara has had to do at times, in order to fund the building of these factories. And finally, you have to accept lower asset turnover. You're not going to generate the same utilization of assets and the same efficiency as a company that's completely outsourcing. And so you have to be able to make up for that with better profit margins, which they've done by having fewer markdowns. But if you don't get that, you run the risk of having much lower returns for your investors. Now, interestingly, Zara has not pursued the same strategy everywhere around the globe. Do they have stores that they own in every country? They have not. In Western Europe, they own their own stores. They are forward integrated. But in some countries, they set up joint ventures to operate stores. And in others, such as in the Middle East, they've actually worked with franchisees who own and operate the stores under a contractual agreement. So Zara exemplifies the idea that there's a spectrum of choices from contracts and markets through full ownership, with franchising and alliances and joint ventures in between. And they varied their corporate strategy, their vertical integration strategy, to fit the conditions in certain countries. In some countries, you have to joint venture. The governments will not allow you to have a wholly owned subsidiary. In others, we have high political instability and really different cultures. So we want local franchisees with a stake in the business who know the local customs and who understand conditions. And by working with franchisees, we put less capital at risk in a politically unstable environment. Can Zara be easily copied? There's a great article about a decade ago by James Surowiecki in The New Yorker. Surowiecki is a regular columnist on business in that magazine, and he's the author of a great book called The Wisdom of Crowds. And writing about Zara, he articulates many of the philosophies of this course on strategy. He says at one point, Zara is an integrated system, not just a collection of parts. You can't simply adopt elements of the system and expect similar results. So think about what we've been preaching in this course, that a great strategy is not about a core competence, but an integrated system of capabilities. An integrated system that fits together really well to produce powerful competitive advantage. And what happens to rivals? They try to copy elements of the system and not the whole thing and cannot produce the same kind of results. And Surowiecki makes the argument that with Zara, you have to be able to do everything they do, not just pieces of what they do, to make that vertical integration strategy so successful. So what are the lessons here? Well, don't just pursue vertical integration to capture the margin. That's not a valid reason to backward or forward integrate. You have to be able to add value by owning different parts of the supply chain. You have to be able to do things more efficiently or effectively than outside parties could do so. You have to understand the costs and benefits of that strategy as well as the alternatives. Could you do it a different way through a long-term relationship, a joint venture, a franchising agreement, some other way that you could achieve some of the benefits without having to put all of the capital in yourself and try to manage it all yourself? And finally, it's not an either-or issue. You don't have to say, are we going to vertically integrate or not, 0-1. You could choose a middle path we call tapered integration, where you do some forward or backward integration, but you still work with outside parties, and you achieve the learning that can happen when you mix the two together in the same corporation. So now for your assignment for this lecture. Take a look at some firms practicing vertical integration. Let's take two, for example. Let's take Apple. Does vertical integration make sense at Apple? They make some of their own inputs, including their own operating system, and they run their own stores. Why might that make sense? And then perhaps contrast that with some retailers who are doing it where it looks like they're less successful. What's different at those retailers? And then look at a firm like Delta in a very different industry. It's an airline that several years ago acquired an oil refinery. Why might they do that? Does it make sense or not, given what we've discussed? And having reviewed that, hopefully you get a better understanding of the rationale and the risks of vertical integration strategies.